idea behind them were to take the skills of mediators, these qualities that we identified here, and help in situations to try to build those relationships, to do some pre-work so that, people would have the ability to handle working together. This one, the projects I've been involved in were funded by the American Arbitration Association, International Center for Dispute Resolution Foundation. So the two were the St. Paul Public Schools, which is the school district where I live, and Fathman Heights, which is a small city just north of St. Paul, Minnesota, where I live. So for the St. Paul Public Schools, this is the school district in St. Paul is very, very diverse. It has, the statistics are 77% of the students in the school come from diverse backgrounds. Now, the city of St. Paul is not nearly as diverse as that. So the public school is much more diverse. And it's these populations that I think are the three largest ones being Somali, Hmong, and Karen. And then there's also a fairly large Latino and Latina population. And the teachers, though, 77% of the students are diverse, and the percent of the teachers that are diverse, 12. So, and like most city urban schools, they suffer from problems with opportunity or achievement gap, that the students of color are not achieving at the same rate that the white students are. And there are issues of climate in the school or safety and things like that. So a variety of underlying concerns. And so when we applied for the grant, we identified this might be a place that we wanted to, and we wanted to have them gather the community together to talk about these issues and to come together as a community to figure out, well, what are we going to do to work together, to improve? And in my view, even though I don't have children in the public schools, I think everybody who lives in St. Paul has a vested interest in the success of our schools and in the success of our students that are in these schools. So it seemed to me that this really was something that would involve everyone. Now, I said, of course, by the time we got the grant, something had happened. Well, what had happened? The school board had an election, and there was a majority of new members came on the board, and one of the first things they did was, well, they ran under description of their platform was change. So what is the first thing they did? They fired the superintendent. So the superintendent's over all of the schools and all of the principals, and so the school district was in a crisis. And so then they were interested in talking to us about doing some community engagement, but not the kind of community engagement we wanted to do. What they wanted to do was gather the community together to talk about what do we want in a new superintendent. And at first we thought, no, maybe we shouldn't do this. I don't know if this is really, we wanted to kind of do big equity kinds of issues. But then we thought, well, actually, maybe this would be a good way, first step, to build some relationships or rebuild relationships that had been severed. Because the community felt very badly about the firing of the superintendent. So we opted to create a process by which they would engage with the community, specifically around the superintendent, and then lead to, hopefully, ultimately another phase where they would deal with the bigger issues. So the first thing, though, that we did was we had some preliminary discussions, and then we did an assessment. So what's an assessment? What do you think we did? If you were sort of faced with this issue, what would you do to figure out what to do next?
To assess the current situation.
And how would you go about that?
Maybe I would facilitate the meeting with the stakeholders.
Okay, so you want to identify stakeholders,
yes.
Right? And so you said have a facilitated meeting with the stakeholders. So that's one way you could do it. What else might you do?
Talk to the stakeholders, identify the stakeholders. Somebody may be particularly likely, somebody may have already threatened to escalate the action. So how the gravity of the potential conflicts can be gauged.
Right. Right, and so, and then what you said first, so we have the two needs, identify and then go talk to them. And actually what we did was talk to them individually. Rather than collectively, individually. We scheduled individual meetings. We had individual meetings with each of the school board members. And then we had a meeting with the acting superintendent. And then we had a meeting with some of the administrative staff. And then we had a meeting with parent advisory councils, and we had meetings with students, and we tried to have as many individual kinds of conversations, and we tried to find out what's going on. What do you think is important? What do you think should be done? What would work for you to be able to provide input? And to collect all of those different ideas together. And so again, what's the underlying mediator thing going on for us? We're not mediators here, right? But what are those skills we're bringing to the table if I do this? What are some of those things?
Identification of issues.
Identification of issues, for sure. Absolutely. Of figuring out, it's like what we do as mediators when we first hear the stories that people bring to them, is we're trying to create what's the agenda of things that need to be done. All right, so identification of issues. What else?
Concern, find the concern of the various stakeholders.
Yeah, so what are their concerns? What are their interests in this? What are they feeling? You know what, to sort of surface those things.
Listening.
Listening. Yeah. And so that they feel that procedural justice. They feel heard. They feel recognized. Someone is listening to me. I matter. Oh, I matter? Wow, then I'm starting to feel a little bit stronger. And then maybe I'm going to be more able to recognize, yeah, you got a tough job, school board. This isn't easy. We have a lot of issues that we're facing. How do we face them together? So all of those things went into this assessment phase. And then my colleague and I wrote a report, a proposal, where we came up with a plan for what we thought we would do. And the plan included several different things. One was, when we talked with the board members, the school board members, what we realized was there was some internal conflict. That some of the people who had been on the board before felt very marginalized now that the new people came in. So we suggested, okay, this isn't only, they wanted us only to deal with community engagement. We said, we think we need to have some meetings with just the school board where you all talk together. And they're like, we don't need that. Well, we think you do. And so they went along with that. And they had facilitated where we ran them like circle processes. You familiar with circle process? Been involved in a circle process? Okay, so again, not a mediation, but mediators can use this technique. So a circle process would be, let's say this was the group that was here. Rather than sitting the way you are, you not be the mediator or the facilitator. I would be called a circle keeper. And a circle keeper would sort of set the parameters of what are we going to talk about. And we would have some kind of a talking piece. And so this might be the talking piece. And if, what's the significance of having a talking piece? That's right. And only the person who has the talking piece can speak. Everybody else listens. And so it's a way to sort of slow down things. And typically, a question is asked to the group, and then you pass the talking piece around. And everyone gets to say what they want. And they, one of the things that it prevents from happening is the immediate need for people to respond. So let's say you say something and it's controversial, and Jay's thinking, oh, that's, I can't stand that. She can't say anything yet because you have this talking piece. And then David's going to have the talking piece. And by the time we get to Jay, she's calmed down a little bit about it. And she might have other things that she wants to say. And so she's not just reacting. And so a circle gives people an opportunity to hear each other in a different way than we often participate in discussions. Because it's more about sort of the sharing. And someone can pass if they want to, so you're not obligated to, but the idea is that there is a sense of people getting to say what they want, and you can, you know, go around as many times. So, so we did that with the school board members and got them to talk a little bit about some things that maybe they each didn't know about the other. So something that their colleagues would be surprised about. So some things that would create some personal connections between them. And then also some things about how did they want to interact together. What were things that would make it easier for them to work together? So that was one piece of it. A second piece of it was to engage the community. And one of the ways that we talked about engaging the community was to create a design team. I'm going to talk about the design team in a moment. The third aspect was to try to help the teachers' union meet with the administration to develop a different way for them to work together. So this was all part of the plan that we put forward, and then we circulated it to everybody who we had spoken to and got them to say, yes, this makes sense. You heard us. Oh, the plan also included what we heard as being the interests. And interestingly, for this particular project, we heard the same things from everybody. Everyone felt like nobody heard and understood them. They all felt that. Everybody felt like the school district was really a great place and needed to be supported. It was incredible consistency across. And so I think that was helpful for them to see it written up that way. So they agreed that they would go forward with doing it. The next slide talks about the design team, so I'm going to skip it. Then we did training of facilitators. So we took people who were already mediators and ask them to assist us in running the small group meetings, because we didn't run exactly like a circle process, but they were small group facilitated conversations so that people could all have voice in a way that they wouldn't get if it was a typical, the school board would sometimes have public comment, but public comment was the kind I talked about before, where people would get 2 minutes, thank you very much, next, next, and it wasn't very fulfilling. And then we collected the input from all of those meetings, There were also some surveys, and we made a final report and recommendation, and the school board has just appointed, hired their new superintendent, and people seem pleased. He hasn't started yet, so I don't know whether they will in fact be pleased, but at the moment, everything seems pretty good for that. So let me come back to this idea of a design team. So, in coming up with a community engagement plan, we talked about the importance of doing an assessment. But the other part of it is figuring out what that engagement will look like. And the best way to design the engagement, again, under this wonderful theories that we have for mediation, is who knows best what's best for them? People themselves. And so rather than say, oh, okay, we are the experts, we have the grant, we are going to tell you how you are going to do this community engagement, we said, what we will do is we will convene representatives of each of the stakeholders, and we will gather them together, and they will help to create what the engagement will look like. They will help to decide where it should be, when it should be, how it should be, who should be included, what should it look like, who should be the facilitator, all of those things. Because, again, as mediators, we have that humility to know we don't have all of the answers. But collectively, we know when people work together and share those ideas that the best decisions are made. So we identify, because we had a good sense already of who the stakeholders were, and then had them identify, okay, so who needs to sit at the table and be part of this design team. And then the design team met, at first it was every 2 weeks, and then once a month, and put together the plan for the community to gather together. So it was a very interesting and good process for doing that. And one of the things that they had to do was come up with what questions or what did we need to think about in community input sessions. So what would you imagine if you were on a design team? What are the kinds of things that you would want to plan for and identify in putting together a community input session? Let's say you wanted to have a community input. What are some of the things that you would have, the decisions you would have to make? Because now I'm asking you to put on sort of as a facilitator for it. So what decisions do you think you would need to make?
Some people will feel comfortable, and I'll be, whoa, I don't go
transport, public and private, both public and private transports.
Right, so how are people going to get there? And so, you know, is it close enough that someone, that public transportation goes near to it? But if, on the same token, is it the kind of place where people are driving? Is there a place that they can park? Is there a way that they can access it? So we can, that kind of accessibility, as well as, you know, if people of different abilities are coming, is it a place where there are ramps, or is there going to be something where there's too many stairs, or things like that? Yeah, excellent. All right, what else might you be thinking about in terms of pulling people together? Anything else? Besides location?
Date and time is often a typical issue.
Yes, that's right. So, date and time. So, what do you need to look for that? And how do you make that decision about, you know, what's the best date? So, what are some considerations you can think about in terms of days?
If the parties who come out are employees, you won't choose office hours.
Right. Okay. So right away, if you choose Monday through Friday during the day, only some people will be able to make this. So you need to, figure out, or do you have to hold both times, right? So maybe there's some people who will only be able to come during the day, but other people can't come during the day, so you need some evening, so some mix.
Duration of meeting.
Yeah.
Provision of temperatures. Yeah.
Right.
Alcohol or not. Sometimes it's good, sometimes
it's
not. Yeah, yeah. So this notion, I mean, timing will also dictate. Or if you have it over the dinner hour, will people expect that you're going to feed them? Do you have the money to do that? Do you want to make sure that it's, like, you know, we were dealing with school population. So there was a lot of concern about not to have it go too late, because those people who had children, you want them in bed. You don't want them staying up too late, and because their parents are in some kind of a meeting. Child care was something that we thought about and provided. So people could, those who had children, could bring them, but still participate. They didn't have to worry about that. Another thing that we had to worry about, I don't know that it would be an issue here, is language. Because there are these different populations, so their children may speak English, but the parents did not necessarily speak English. And so we had to make sure that we had facilitators who spoke Somali, and Mom, and Corinne, and had the ability for them also to participate.
The key, another key thing is how to ensure that those who will be, who are turning up for this event represent what is a fair representation of the group of people that you are targeting at.
Right. So, this is a really tricky and difficult point, but one that absolutely you need to think about. As you are engaging with the community, who is coming and are they representative? And if they are not representative, because here's what we figured, we realized that in designing this, that when you hold an open meeting and say, come to this meeting, what I said about in the critique of, when I talked about the pop-up, the same people always show up. Now, are they the only people who have anything to say? No. It's just that they feel very comfortable in this environment, and so they show up at these meetings. But they're not representative of the full community. So one of the other things that was done was, in addition to the open meetings, there were 5 open meetings, 4 of them during the evening and 1 on a Saturday, so again, to try to mix that up, was to offer and then to also target different populations and different groups and say, we will come to you. You schedule a meeting whenever it's convenient for you and your group, and we will send a facilitator, and we will talk with you. And we will have the same questions, and you will be able to provide input in that same way. So you don't have to go. We will come to you. And so on the school's website, there was a place for people to request a meeting. And because we weren't sure that people would necessarily request, we actually reached out to several groups that we said, we know that the Somali community is not going to just show up, and they're not going to request. So we are going to call them. We're going to say, we want to come and talk to you. When can we come talk to you? And so to address this very issue. Yeah. But those are exactly the kinds of things that you wanted. So we talked about all of this. Excellent job of identification of what those issues are with it. Okay. So I'll give you a very different example. So this is, let's see, how are we doing on that? Oh, it's already, okay. So Falcon Heights is the city that is very close to where I live in St. Paul, Minnesota. It's just north of it, and it's a small city. It's a city that has many professors that live there because it's very close to the University of Minnesota, which is a very large school. And the background there was, there's a major thoroughfare, a major road that goes from downtown St. Paul to downtown Minneapolis. And it runs through this community. And this community is so small that it doesn't have its own police force. It has a police force that it shares with a neighboring community. They contract it. Have this police force. And one evening, a black man and his girlfriend and his girlfriend's daughter are driving down the road, and the police pull up next to him and stop him. He pulls over, and within one moment, literally 1 minute of him being pulled over, he is shot dead. And his girlfriend records the whole thing on Facebook, live streams it, and so immediately everybody knows what has happened. There's great unrest and horror. Just the community is absolutely horrified that this happened. Up in arms, they don't want this police force anymore. They want something to be done, you know. Just a lot of angst. And the community here, it raised the issue of how do you define community. Because it wasn't just the residents of Falcon Heights that were outraged and upset and wanted something done. It was much, much broader than that. And in fact, there was a sit-in in front of the governor's mansion where people were camping out there to express their displeasure and that something needed to be done. And so the city commission decided, first, they held a public hearing. And people came up and they were very angry and they were yelling and whatever, and the city commission got nervous and they got up and they left. As you can imagine, this did not go over very well. So they knew they needed something different in order to address this issue. And so what they did was first to establish a task force. And this is what the charge for the task force is, because this task force is still ongoing. To articulate, affirm, and operationalize our values as a community to be an inclusive and welcoming environment environment for residents and guests of Falcon Heights. So the first thing had to do with sort of this broader idea of what are the values we have as a community. And then the second part is with an emphasis on policing values, policies, and procedures. So it was sort of this dual goals, mission for the task force. The city commission was still going to have to make the decision around the police contract. The task force was not going to do it. They were going to provide input, though, to the city. And then, so there's the city commission, there's the task force, and then the task force said, and we want to engage the community. Because we want to know and heal this community, and also to know what the community wants. And we want to engage them in a way that's going to be much more productive than having everybody yelling and screaming and unhappy. And so the design team that we created for this one actually was different, very different than the one we created for the school, because this one were just experts to, as opposed to, because the stakeholder groups was basically everyone. And so we went with sort of an expert team to figure out what that design team, what the community conversation should look like. And these were done in survey. And the idea was there would be 5 community conversations. And I have the question there, how do you define community? So in this case, they very purposely said, when we talk about community, we mean everybody. We're inviting everybody. Because we are all part of the broader community that was impacted by this. And so the decision was that there would be 5 conversations over a period of a couple of months. And the first one was around values and healing. And so the groups came together, about 100 people have come to each of the conversations. They started all together with some open remarks and then were broken up into groups of about 8 to 10 people that sat in circle with the circle keeper who asked a question. And so I actually included for the first one what those questions were. So the first question was, why did they come and what's their most important value as a person? So that they could each talk about that. And then they were asked what value they most like their neighbors and public officials to demonstrate and why. So see, it's all about this value. And then the value that they would most like their neighbors and public officials to demonstrate, how they would like to see the city of Falcon Heights heal, and how they would like to see themselves, their neighbors, and their public officials demonstrate the values. And all of that information was collected from each of the circles, and then it was put on a website. And from that, so these values were articulated. And I could show you, they ended up coming up with, a pamphlet that has a statement of the values. So the values that they came out with were leadership, trust, transparency, and accountability, equity and justice, welcome and inclusion, educate selves and seek diverse perspectives, take courageous action, and safety. And they're color-coded because in the later conversations, they talked about how could they take those values and operationalize them so that how would these values show up in the activities and policing and policy and other practices. And so later from that, they've got recommendations that tie to the specific values, with the idea that they could then sort of bring this all together. So that happened in the second conversation was about sort of attaching values to action kinds of things. The third conversation was after the task force came up with recommendations to react to the recommendations. And then we just had the last one last week, number four, and that was about transformational change. What would that look like? What is it that would need to happen? And we asked each of the participants to identify what they personally were committing to do. And they came up with a wonderful list of things of being more actively involved, spending time with teachers, reaching out to the other, going to community events, doing, I mean, just a whole host of things, but it was personal commitments that they were willing to do. The last conversation, which is not yet, oh, I think actually it is now scheduled, it's in June, after the task force has finished its recommendations, and it will be a commemoration of Philando Castile, who is the gentleman who was killed, as well as planning for next steps. So a very different kind of community engagement, but again, I hope that you can see that it's infused with all of these things, and the people that we utilize to run the circles were all people who were trained in mediation. Not because they were going to mediate, but because we knew that they were good listeners. We knew that they understood what conflict is. They understood people's, the Maslow hierarchy. They understood the importance of procedural justice. All of it, they had empathy, they had humility, all of those things that would be important for people to have some kind of a healing experience and share their values was what we wanted. So, comments, questions on this one? Yes?
I think this is a very good exercise. And I think the key issue, one of the key issues is the level of trust that people have in respect to task force. May I know who appoint this task force? Who are there? You know, how representative are them?
Yeah, so the task force was appointed by the city. They took applications, and so people had to explain both their background and also why they wanted to be on the task force. And they purposely selected a diverse group from the community. And I think that they are pleased with it. I think that that has been working well. And I also should mention that at the community conversations, that there have been a wide range of people who have come to those as well, including friends of Philando Castile have come. Family members have not, although they have been, people have reached out to them, they have been spoken to about ways that whether this is working for them or not. And also members of the police department have come and shared their feelings and sat with people, which I think is also pretty powerful.
Many people are there in the task force and the racial distribution?
So the task force is, so I haven't been working as closely with the task force, but I think that I've been to some of their meetings. It's about, I want to say, 15 people. They are fairly representative of Falcon Heights. Falcon Heights itself is not a very diverse community. The co-chair is this incredibly wonderful African-American woman who's also a pastor, who is just, she speaks from the heart and is just, she's a Falcon Heights resident and has done a lot of work around equity and inclusion. And her co-chair is a member of the city council, who is a white man, a more typical person who doesn't always quite understand, that sometimes he's not quite getting it. But she has been wonderful in working with him, and so they're a good team. And then there are a variety of different members in the task force. So, I mean, it remains to be seen what will happen, because one of the challenges that they have come up with is the reality of not, of what to do about the police. Because they're too small of a city to have their own police force and have a police force that would be able to have all of the training and everything that they want. They would never be able to afford the police force that they want. So there's that reality. Secondly, the police force that they were contracting with sort of got their bent out of shape a little bit because there were so many fingers being pointed at them. They said, they took a vote at their city council, and the city council said, if you still retain us, you have to pay for all of the extra training and everything that you do. You're gonna have to pay a premium to get our services. So that did not go over very well. And they don't really have any other choices. And because they put out a bid and said, what other groups would like to provide police force to us? And nobody came forward. So they're in a bit of a quandary at the moment. And having said that, I think it makes it even more important that they've done this kind of work. Because when they now have to figure out what to do, they actually will have only bad choices in front of them that the community will understand. And you mentioned trust. It's about building that trust in them. So that they will be able to say, yes, we've done all of this, and now we understand and trust you. That's the whole point.
So. You get paid.
Did I get paid? So no, actually, because we did it under this grant, so we did not charge for any of the services that we provided. Which again, I think is the great challenge, is to figure out how can you do this. How can you provide these services so that the people who would benefit from it will actually undergo them? And it was a great benefit to be able to say to them, you don't have to pay us. We will do this. We will provide these services. And you can't always do that because there's not always very much.
It's good credibility about the whole exercise because you're not paid.
Yeah, well, and I think that's right. It certainly helped for us to be able to say, we're not doing this for the money. We are doing this because we want to help. We want to be of service.
Was the officer who fired Fidel Shores convicted?
Not yet. He has been charged. It is a slow process. So he has not had a trial. But they did, in the United States, there have been several times instances where there has been somebody who's been killed and then they're not even charged. And that creates great unhappiness in the community. But they did decide to charge him. It's very difficult to convict, but the fact that it was literally, part of why we know so much about what happened is not only was it being live streamed, but the police now wear body cameras. That's one of the changes that's happened. And so that's how they knew it was 1 minute. And that they said was critical in their thinking about charging.
Do you, in your own opinion, that if the victim is black, the police officers are more ready to fire shots? Some
yes.
Troublemakers, white, and after 5, 6, 10, 12 minutes, they have not fired.
Yes. No, unfortunately, this is in the United States right now, this is absolutely true. There's been a lot of, in fact, one of the things that they want to come out of this is training in implicit bias. You're familiar with implicit bias? This bias itself is, When is the stuff that is explicit. You know. You can see it, you can talk about it. Implicit bias is things that go on in your head that you don't even realize. And so what happens for many police is they describe that they are fearful, that they were afraid that they were going to be shot or attacked or whatever. And but that's mainly, it's implicit because it's not based in any kind of reality. It's just so, just one other piece of information that might be interesting to you. So Philando Castile was actually carrying a gun. Many of the other people who had been shot were unarmed. He was, but he had a permit for a concealed weapon. And he did exactly what you are taught to do if you have a concealed weapon. I don't know this right, because I don't have a concealed weapon permit, but they say that you are, if you are pulled over, you are to say to the police, I have a concealed weapon, I have a permit for the concealed weapon, I can show you the permit if you would like. And you know, to sort of keep the hands on the wheel and say all of this. And so he did have a weapon, but he was not reaching for it, he wasn't doing anything. And that we know from the.
But he was not raising his hands.
Yeah.
So from what I heard just now, before you talk about the implicit
bias,
isn't that the police at that time, that particular police might have his fear?
Yeah.
So if you go back to that model,
yeah.
Am I right to understand that, that perhaps that policeman felt weak and therefore he went self-assault that put him to do what he did? And might be that that have projection onto the whole police force.
Mm-hmm.
So if the community can bring empowerment and recognition to the police force as a whole,
yeah.
Perhaps something might be able to change.
I think that's right, and I think you raise a very important point that is demonstrated in this model, that it's not about sort of attacking and blaming and making that police force feel worse and worse, you know, whatever, but rather how to recognize what is the legitimate, at least put their lives in danger all the time. And then I would want to be a police officer. And so sort of to recognize and appreciate the work that they do. And yes, it doesn't mean you can hold two things, because that's the other thing that mediators know how to do, right? To hold competing things in your head at the same time. That it can be this and also this. This police officer did something that was wrong, and that there is legitimate fear and concern that people have, and sometimes bad things happen. And so sort of to recognize both of those things and then to figure out how to help people then for all to be raised up, to create sort of that upward cycle.
I have missed that point.
So we haven't had the last circle yet, but the last circle is going to be a commemoration of Philando Castile. So initially, so this is again how language sometimes is important. Originally we were going to talk about a celebration of having completed the process, a celebration and next steps. And everyone was like, whoa. Well, this all started by the death of someone. We can't be celebrating. There's no celebrating here. So it's going to be a commemoration and next steps, because the process, these five community conversations will end, but what we want to leave everybody with is, it's not over. So this will be about this piece of it maybe ending, and what are the next steps? Where are you going to go from here?
And by that, you might be, the task force might also be adding value to the unfortunate and sad death of that. To pay tribute to.
Yeah, exactly. And to figure out, yes, how to make it so that at least it won't be entirely in vain, that there will be some outcome that maybe the community will be in a better place, and this doesn't happen again, at least here. there have been, I think it has done the job of doing healing. We have not evaluated yet, but we will be doing it. And that's the last piece I'll say, is that one of the other challenges with this is how do you assess how successful it was and whether it has worked? And so there's some interesting work being done around ripple effect. And ripple effect is a mapping of not just for the people who participated, because so we could talk about, well, what did this mean for all of you? But actually, community engagement, what's really important is, who did you talk to when you left here? And what work did you do? And what work did you do? And where else did you touch somebody? And how did this spread through the community? So it's not just about the people who participated in the conversation. It's all of the other people that they're related to, or they talked to, or they reached out to. And that's how you create community change. Because I said there's about 100 people who have been showing up for these things. It's not the same 100. There's probably a core of about, I don't know, 30 maybe, that have come to all of them. And then there's some that have, you know, come in and out and other ones come. So that's not all of the residents. But the hope is that you touch those people and they spread all of that. So it's... to be continued, as we said. So we didn't get to the sealed building piece, but I think that this probably, I think you have a flavor of at least what I was hoping that you would retain from this workshop, that each of you, the mediation skills that you are developing and have developed and the knowledge and expertise can be used in a variety of different ways. The last one I'll mention to you is where there is crisis, and you can use your skills there too. And some of that I would describe as being an ally and helping people to see the other perspective. Because often when there is that crisis, there's blame placed on that, on the people, and there's a sense of sort of pushing them aside, but you can use your ability to understand perspectives to help other people to appreciate, well, what might have been going on for them? Why might they be acting like this? And being that kind of an ally can help. So there's a variety of different ways. The easiest ones are before anything starts, but at each point, you can bring value. And I hope that you will, and I will be anxious to read and to hear about all of the wonderful things that continue to happen in Hong Kong based on the work that you all do. So thank you for spending the time.
Thank you indeed, Sharon. I think here is a very good chance for us to be intrigued by the talk, because it's pulling together many areas of wisdoms that we may, as mediators, not have thought about at all. Say, for example, transformative mediation. And when you think about circles, maybe restorative justice mediation, which is also having a healing effect. And of course, this field system design that requires some techniques indeed in organizing different areas of meetings, approaching each and every party individually. So mediation is not about confining ourselves into a tiny confidential room at all. And we should be able to be powerful enough, empowered, to step outside that room and be able to bring our community powers and meanings. And I hope that we see that happen very soon. Thank you, Sharon, again for being here. This year is our final year of having mediation talks and negotiation persuasion topics. Next one will be happening on the 16th of June by Professor Dennis Wong. So if you don't mind, just come up in a hurry and stay tuned on our announcement soon. And after summer break, we'll have more workshops by local academics as well as people. final talk will be by Professor Michelle Lever from the University of British Columbia in Vancouver, Canada. In around November, the date is not fixed, but still the same day. So keep this. We've got the website here where you can review this lecture and other lectures as well. And of course, new information will be there.
And don't miss that one with Michelle Barron.
Really? Don't miss that. Don't miss that because we are all videotaped.